Hello friends, this video on Matter and Surroundings Part 7 is brought to you by examfear.com. No more fear from exam. Let's see if the matter can change state. We all know that the ice, if you heat it up, it becomes water. If you further heat it up, it becomes water vapors. So solid, liquid and gas are interconvertible. We know that. So let's do an experiment. Here we have this beaker. In this beaker we have ice cubes and there's a thermometer. So if you notice the temperature here, the temperature may be, let's suppose, minus 10 degrees Celsius. So let me put a graph here. It is minus 10 degrees Celsius, and then we have 0 degrees Celsius, and then we have 100, and let's suppose we have 120 at the max. It's all in Celsius. So when we start heating, you will notice the temperature also. When you start heating, you'll see that, but gradually when you heat, all these ice will melt and will become water. So temperature will increase from minus 10 to 0. And then for some time, even if you heat, the temperature will remain constant at 0 degrees Celsius. And then after some time, when you heat further, the temperature will increase to 100 degrees Celsius. When you heat further, you'll see water vapors, and the temperature will be constant for some time, and then it will further increase. So if you see, this is the kind of graph you will get actually, right? So it was at minus 10 degrees Celsius. Let's suppose the ice cubes were at minus 10 degrees Celsius. When you heated it up, the temperature rose to 0 degrees Celsius, and then it became constant for some time till all the water melts. So this is the place where ice is converted to water. And then when you heat it further, you will notice this. Actually, you can do this in your home as well. When you heat this further, you will see that this is the zone where water gets converted into vapors. This is what you will observe here. So here we are seeing the conversion from solid to liquid, that is ice to water. And then we'll also see conversion from liquid to gas, that is water vapor, water to water vapors. Okay. So we'll start heating in the low frame, and we'll see that as the temperature rises, the water melts and finally it becomes water vapor. And please note that you do the same thing in your home and try to observe the temperature. Okay, so now let's see the first scenario, that is solid to liquid. Okay, solid to liquid, that is ice to water. Let's take the scenario one. So in this case, when you increase the temperature, this is was the case we had. This was a solid. When you increase the temperature, after some time it became liquid. We'll take the scenario now. So when you increase the temperature, this solid, the kinetic energy of the particles of this solid will also increase. So Ke of particles. Please note, I am telling you kinetic energy of the particles. I am not telling you kinetic energy of the ice cubes. The ice cubes is almost at the stationary level. There is no kinetic energy of the ice cubes as such. But we are talking about the kinetic energy of the particles. So as you increase the temperature and supply more and more heat, what is happening is the kinetic energy of this water particles is increasing. And these particles starts vibrating. They start vibrating with a greater speed. When you supply more and more heat, this heat overcomes the force of attraction between the particles, because these particles will have some force of attraction. When you supply more and more heat, these particles will overcome the force of attraction between them, and these particles will leave their position and start moving. They'll leave their position and will start moving. They'll start moving freely actually. So a stage will be reached where all these solid will melt and will convert to liquid. So all these solid will melt and will convert to liquid. This is the stage it will reach. And this stage is called melting point. If you see the curve here, the temperature was constant for some time where all the ice actually melted to water. And this temperature is called melting point. For water, it is 0 degrees Celsius. This temperature is called melting point, 273.16 Kelvin or 0 degrees Celsius. Okay, so this process of melting of solid state to liquid state is called fusion. So this process is called fusion. From solid to liquid, change of state is called fusion. Please note, this is a new term, solid to liquid change of state is called fusion. Also, one thing that you notice here is, as the temperature we are increasing, but still, I mean, we are supplying more and more heat, but still the temperature was constant for a certain period. When the ice was melting to water, at that time the temperature was same. Where does the heat energy go? Why there was no temperature increase from this time to this time? There should be some reason, right? See, the reason is that the temperature of the system didn't change. That is something we know after this melting point is reached. Why? Because this heat extra, but which we are supplying, which we are supplying from this time to this time, let's suppose this is the time on this axis, right? From this is time T1 and this is time T2. From T1 to T2, whatever extra heat we supplied, that heat is actually used to melt ice to liquid. Okay, this heat is used to change, or if you talk in a generic sense, this heat is used to change the solid state to liquid state, right? The heat during T1 to T2, this heat is used actually to change solid state to liquid state. Okay, this actually is used by the solid ice cubes to overcome the force of attraction and become liquid. Now, since this energy is absorbed by the ice without showing any temperature rise, it is considered that this energy gets hidden in the whole system, obviously, right? Because you're supplying some heat and there is no change, so it looks like it is hidden, but actually this energy is used to break the bonds of the solids so that solid can be converted to liquid. But since from overall perspective it looks like this energy which we have supplied from T1 to T2 time frame, that energy is somewhere lost, looks like. Please note, it is not actually lost, it is used actually, we have seen that, to convert, actually melt this ice that is solid to liquid, because this ice has stronger force of attraction, the bonding was strong, and this heat was used to convert this ice to liquid. But it looks that this energy is absorbed by the whole system, and absorbed has a Latin word called latent. Latent is hidden. So this, there's a new term called latent heat. So in this case, there is a term called latent heat. And since this heat was used for the fusion process, so this is latent heat of fusion. Why? Because this heat, latent means hidden. Latent word means hidden. So it looks like this energy, whatever was supplied between T1 and T2 interval, that got hidden in the whole system, right? The whole system includes the ice, the water and the beaker. So it is also called latent heat. So we'll define the term latent heat of fusion. The amount of energy required to change 1 kg of solid into liquid at atmospheric pressure, because these values will actually change depending on the pressure. So now we are doing the observations, are the experiment we are doing in the open lab, and open lab we have here the atmospheric pressure of 1 atm, right? If you do the same thing in some mountain, the atmospheric pressure will change, okay? Because you go up, the atmospheric pressure decreases actually. Okay, so that is something you know. So the point I'm trying to say is that latent heat of fusion is nothing but, let me write here, amount of heat energy required to change 1 kg of solid to liquid at atmospheric pressure. Okay, at its melting point. So two things note here is, and this is called latent heat of use. So if you see this, everything is happening at 0 degrees Celsius, and in this case of water, this 0 degrees Celsius is nothing but melting point. So amount of heat required to change 1 kg of solid from solid to liquid state at melting point at atmospheric pressure is nothing but latent heat of fusion. Okay, this is done. Now we'll talk about liquid to gas. So let's talk about liquid to gas. Liquid to gas. So now once we have liquid, when you heat it further, you'll see that you'll see the water vapors coming up. Here also, if you increase the temperature, you heat it up, you'll see the temperature increasing, and after some time again, here also you'll see the temperature becomes constant. Right, so after all the ice is melted at 0 degrees Celsius, now we are at here at T2 position, all the ice is melted, you supply more heat, and after some time T3, you'll see that the temperature of the system has increased to 100 degrees Celsius. Okay, and the particles are moving all the more faster. Why it is becoming vapors? Because here the particles were moving a little slow, but now the particles get more kinetic energy. It's all kinetic energy of the particles. When you supply more heat, see, the reason everything is happening is, when you supply more heat, kinetic energy of particles actually increase on supplying heat. This is the main cause of all these things, whatever we are seeing here. Let me change the color. So this is kinetic energy. When you supply kinetic energy, when you supply heat energy, the heat energy actually gets converted into kinetic energy of the particles. Please note, not the kinetic energy of the whole system, kinetic energy of the particles. Now, when you talk about the liquid to gas, you supply more and more heat. So at T3 temperature, you will see at time T3, this is time, at time T3, you will see that the temperature has become 100 degrees Celsius. And then again, it becomes flat for some time. Right? So when all the ice has melted at T2, you supply more heat. You reach a time T3 where the temperature is 100 degrees Celsius, and at this point the kinetic energy of the particles is pretty high. They are moving at very, very high speed, and when you supply all the more heat, now the temperature is constant. Why? Because at this point the temperature has reached 100 degrees Celsius. 100 degrees Celsius is nothing but boiling point for water. So at this point water starts boiling. Right, this at this temperature you have enough energy to break free from all the force of attraction, and thus this liquid starts changing into gas. So this is the point from T3 where liquid starts changing to gas. Right, here also you will see from T3 to T4 the temperature will remain same for some time. That is 100 degrees Celsius. Here also same logic as we have seen in the latent heat of fusion. We have latent heat of something else, that is latent heat of vaporization, because now this process of converting liquid to gas is called vaporization. Right, since this is called vaporization, so this heat, latent heat, is called latent heat of vaporization. So this latent heat of vaporization is nothing but the amount of heat required to transform 1 kg of liquid to gas at STP, and this has to be measured at boiling point. Let me write here, amount of heat energy required to change 1 kg of liquid to gas at STP or ATM at its boiling point, and this is called latent heat of vaporization. So if you see here, This is also called latent heat because you're supplying some heat energy. Temperature of the system is not increasing. You feel that temperature is getting absorbed somewhere hidden. So it's called latent heat. But this is called latent heat of vaporization. So we have learned a lot of terms here. Fusion, that is conversion of solid to liquid. Vaporization, that is conversion of liquid to gas. Latent heat of fusion, amount of energy required to convert 1 kg of solid to liquid at ATM at its melting point is called latent heat of fusion. Latent heat of vaporization, amount of heat required to change 1 kg of liquid to gas at ATM, I mean at 1 atmospheric pressure actually, or I can say 1 atmospheric pressure at its boiling point, and that is called latent heat of vaporization. Okay. So now something you should observe here is at this point from T1 to T2, here if you see the ice and water both coexist. Because this is the time we have partial ice and partial water. Because when you start heating, all of a sudden all the ice does not go off immediately, right? It takes some time. Gradually you will see a time where you have some ice, some water. Similarly, when you have a boiling water, all the water, boiling water, does not convert into gas in one shot. It takes time, right? Some of them get converted. So same thing here. Okay, so these things should note. Also, one thing to note here is at this temperature between T1 to T2 range, let's suppose, and you have ice also and you have water also, okay, both are at 0 degrees Celsius, let's suppose here. So tell me which will have more energy. Both are having same temperature, one is ice, one is water in the same beaker. Which will have more energy? Obviously particles of water, because particles of water, you know that particles of water, they are loosely bounded as compared to particles of ice. They'll have more energy, they'll roam around in a faster way. Same thing here, between T3 and T4 you'll have water also, you'll have water vapors also. Which will have more energy? Obviously water vapor, because in water vapors both are at same temperature though, but in water vapors the force of attraction between the particles is almost nil, and they are free to move around, and they move around at very, very high speed. We showed you one PPT where we have shown three different states, solid, liquid and gas, and how these particles move around, right? Solid, the speed of the particles was very slow, liquid was a medium, and gases, the particle speed was very high. Okay, this is about change of matter from solid to liquid and liquid to gas. Okay, some substance actually directly convert from solid to gas. We'll talk about that. But here, plus understand in all these cases, what is most important is the kinetic energy, and that's why you have this picture. So the when you heat, when you supply heat, the only thing that happens is the kinetic energy of the particles increase. Since the kinetic energy of the particles increase, they vibrate and they move away from each other, their speed increase. And we have seen that solid, liquid and gas, the properties differ primarily because the kinetic energy of the particles. Correct. So if the kinetic energy of the particles is very high, it will be gas. If the kinetic energy of the particle is very low, it will be typically solid. So here also, what we are doing is, we took a solid, that is ice cube here, which had, whose particle had less kinetic energy, we supplied more heat, and with that, the kinetic energy of the particles increased and it changed its state. Okay.
Thank you. Visit examfear.com to watch more videos, attempt free online tests, get pre-study materials, find tutors and mentors, and much more. Thanks once again.